Okay, so Western blotting is a big name, but before we get into that, how many people know who this is? That's the fastest man in the world, Bolt. But how many people know who that is? That's the guy who came second. Right? He's actually from Trinidad and Tobago, and he's actually my second cousin. So at that time, he was the second fastest guy in the world. And I'm from a country called Trinidad and Tobago, and that's where I did my PhD. And there, we're very fortunate that we're not given kits, or we're not given things, we're not shown how to do things. We actually have to do it by trial and error. So we're able to learn a lot. And while doing electrophoresis and Western blotting, I had a lot of failure and I had a lot of success, and I was able to really understand the theory and understand why and what we need for a good Western blot. And that actually is during my PhD that I got the experience to know what's a good Western blot and what's not. And as the theory improved, my understanding got even better and I was able to do even more. But this is Trinidad. It's a Caribbean island, so it's just like any other country in the Caribbean. It has beautiful beaches, and we have something unique called doubles. And if you ever visit Trinidad, please enjoy doubles, but please go to a place which has a lot of crowd. Don't ever go to a place that has no one next to it, all right? It's good for your stomach. My research is actually on the proteasome and troponins, and I'm especially interested in the proteomics of this with respect to diseases such as cardiomyopathies. And I really like muscle because without it, we'd kind of look like this, you know, and I like to look a little bit more meaty. So why do we need Western blots? If you know a protein is in a sample and it's in a very small amount, the best technique out there right now to detect it is still Western blot. It's the most cost effective and it's the most accurate. So can we trust Western blots? The short answer is yes, we can trust it. The long answer is, however, there's too many poor quality Western blots out there with inaccurate results. It's not that people are trying to falsify data, that's another problem, or people are manipulating the data. It's that some people just don't know good practices and are getting incorrect results. One is at the level of the actual data, but a lot is at the level of just the quantification. So we have multiple problems at the level of Western blot that's holding back the field. So this is a typical Western blot from our lab, and sometimes you get really nice error bars, everything works well, and then sometimes things don't work as well. But that's life. That's variability between animals and stuff when done properly. So to get that, there are multiple steps. There's always some kind of SDS page. There are multiple different great companies making great apparatus for this. There's transfer equipment, which we'll go through in a little bit more detail. There's either primary or secondary antibody, or one antibody with a tag on it already, so you can do just one step. There's always some kind of detection reagent, and there's always some type of imager. It could be film or digital imaging. And we'll get into more details on that. One thing I realized very early on when I was a graduate student is that you can't always trust even the experts, which is the companies, because some of the things they tell you, you don't have to follow. In a third world country, we can't afford to buy everything and do everything as recommended. And if we were to order something from Turmo or Bio-Rad or Sigma, it takes 2 to 3 months to reach. So we had to make sure and understand what we're doing and make sure we had enough reagents. So I actually did some experiments early on using a spectrometer to measure the gel rate at which gel with temperature, amount of different reagents, and I was able to find out that things that we commonly take for granted, for example, ammonium persulfate, is told to always use it fresh. We found that newer batches, the older batches, had impurities in it that caused that problem. Companies are making it so good now that you can take it, freeze it in aliquot, it would last over a year. Not a problem. Timed, same thing. Degassin is overrated. We have compared degassin versus non-degassin for making small gels. We don't see a difference in results, Westerns, nothing, or even in speed of gelling. But for big gels, it makes a difference. So there were a lot of things we could cut out and actually save time and money. However, Western blotting is not perfect, even when you correct all the mistakes. You have to realize the limitations of Western blotting. Western blotting, you have to realize that sometimes post-translational modifications, such as phosphorylation or oxidation, could actually appear as 2 or 3 bands. And some people will just take the band that's of the correct molecular weight theoretically and use that and quantify, while the other bands are actually really important bands too because they're from that protein. And a lot of people don't realize that. Secondly, if primary antibodies are not affinity purified, we see a lot of problems with them, recognizing non-specific targets. This is a real problem that we'll get into in a little while. The technique is really, in a lot of literature, it's said to be labor intensive, but in my lab, I don't find it that labor intensive because we have minimized it, and I'll show you at the end, we actually do Westerns in about 3 hours. However, the technique is really variable between labs. You can go to the lab next door to yours, even in a company, and they'll be doing Western blotting slightly differently. This is a big problem in the field. So how many people have had a blot that looks strange like this? All right. So if you run enough blots, you're going to encounter this, especially if you have undergrads in the lab, right? Because the wrong exam time, their head is not on properly. They're not thinking about what they're doing. So one major problem is we have serious problems in the literature with respect to Western blotting. I'm only going to show some very delicate ones. I'm not going to show the very obvious, so it'll come up a little bit more clear. And I'm not picking on any one journal. I'm using this journal because it's not copyrighted, and I can use it without having to pay any royalties, and you all can have it there to take home with you. But you can see here, this band, G2, you cannot quantify that accurately. Yet they are. I'm getting beautiful, and look at the error bar. Clearly wrong. It's impossible. You can take that figure they have there, just print it out, and do a densitometry, the old school densitometry, and you can see. It's inaccurate. More subtle is when people show like this, where they cut out the bands and show one. If you look carefully, these have a different intensity of background than this, meaning it came from a different gel. You cannot compare accurately different gels unless you have a lot of standards involved. So we have a lot of problems that are very subtle that people don't realize. So where problems occur is at any step. Some people don't realize that problems can occur at sample preparation. Problems can occur in the gel. Problems can occur during the electrophoresis. Problems can occur during the transfer. But the major problem occurs during this blocking antibody incubation. Then you have problems with the detection reagent. Batch-to-batch detection reagents has varied a lot over the last 2 years in my lab. Different companies are given different qualities depending on when you get it. And that's a big concern. Because if that is not consistent and you're getting different results, a lot of people blame it on the antibody, because they don't realize the ECL reagent is important. And the last but not least, very important, is quantification. So like everything else, if you want to have a good day, it said you have to have a good breakfast. If you want to do a good Western, you have to have a good gel. The quality of the gel is really important. And we spend a lot of time making sure our gels are good. And that's one of the reasons why we recently switched to the stain-free, because we can actually stain quickly before the gel is transferred to see if there's any problems, especially when you have a lot of undergrads repeating experiments. So when we do experiments and we get a result, we have undergrads repeat it to see that someone else can repeat it. Because our belief is if an undergrad can repeat it, anyone can repeat it, anyone with technical skill. So in this gel, you can see 20 and 25 microgram of rat heart homogenate run, and we do this so we can get a discrimination between the antibody two, and we'll run multiple of these, cut these out, and then do different incubations to tell us what's going on. And we like to run two different concentrations because it makes sure that this is within the linear part of the curve. So if the gel is not good, you'll have problems quantifying later on, if your gel is wavy, etc. But during the electrotransfer, earlier on, we found a lot of problems. We had switched about 6 years ago to semi-dry blotting, and we had a lot of problems, and we switched back. But over the last 3 years, the technology by most companies has improved to such a point that the electrotransfer with these fast transplots are so much better now. They're not better than the normal liquid blot method. They just make it faster. The accuracy is the same. It's not an improvement. It just makes everything faster. And in my hands, time is money. So faster means better for me. So I can cut down now from doing 2 transfers in 1 hour to doing 4 transfers in 7 minutes, right? That makes a big difference for my lab. Because now people now, they no longer give me the, I have to do the Western. They now say, yeah, Westerns, no problem. So The problem with all blotting is above 140 kilodalton, you have to optimize. It doesn't matter what technique you use. That's another limitation of Western blotting. You have to optimize for high molecular weight proteins. It doesn't matter whether you use one of the new blotters or you use the old techniques. You have to know how long to transfer and what's the best membrane to actually capture those. How many people have seen blots like that? Most people here, right? This is the identical samples. This is stain for just 1 minute with 5% BSA. This is stain for 1 hour with 5% BSA. This is just to demonstrate the clear indication when you're under block. But there are many other factors that can cause this, including putting too much primary antibody or too much secondary antibody. Now, a little quiz. This is one of the major problems in the field is saturation. Spend 10 seconds, look at those figures. How many people think A is saturated? How many people think B? How many think C is saturated? D? E? Wow, a lot of people don't know which is saturated, right? Both D and E are saturated. Now take a close look at D. If you see this published in a journal, you would have no clue that that is saturated because the quality now of these images are so good, you really can't tell, especially if they optimize the gamma factor, etc. You cannot tell anymore. So there's so much easy manipulation that can happen that allows this, right? The good thing about these software, though, is they tell you. In all digital images now, they tell you when it's saturated. Why is this important? It'll come to that. Another quiz. Which one is saturated? A, B, or C? How many people like A? All right, we have 3, 4. How many people like B? We have about 6. How many people say C? Wow. Both A and C are saturated. Yet you can't tell. That's my point. And that's the problem with film. There's a serious problem with film in the literature because you cannot tell when it's saturated. We have with the digital imagers software that tells us this. I can't tell. You can't tell. That's why we need things that are unbiased, because when we want a result with this kind of image, you can get the result you want by changing parameters. So it's really important that we know about this saturation problem. This paper in PLOS One shows clearly a lot of people think that film is more sensitive than an imager. That's incorrect. What film is, it saturates faster. So it gives the false impression that it's more sensitive. And this is a big problem in the literature because a lot of older scientists, they will use a digital imager and then switch back to using film because they say, we can't get the same sensitivity. It's not the sensitivity, it's a false sense. You can see here that a CCD imager is 3 logs higher sensitivity than film. Yet the film looks better, but that's just an artificial look. If you take this and you increase the gain post image, you can get any image looking like this. So film is really should be phased out slowly unless you're validating your saturation points with the film, which is really hard. Another major problem in the field is this loading control. And this is what I'm going to spend a little proportion of time on, because over the last 2 years, I have switched completely from housekeeping proteins to total protein staining. And the reason for that is because there's so many problems with housekeeping proteins. You have to normalize for each one. So if you look here, you see a summary from this recent paper of about 12 papers that showed problems with housekeeping proteins. I had an undergrad document go through the literature and find, and he found 36 papers to date that shows problems with GAPDH, beta tubulin, and actin in the literature. Specific references to those being problematic with Westerns. And I will show you data now that we have found in our lab also. One thing that people don't realize is that these housekeeping proteins are highly modified. Not many of you all realize these things are highly phosphorylated. They're highly acetylated. They're highly ubiquitinated. These all affect how these antibodies to them recognize them. So what we have found in my lab is depending on the beta tubulin antibody you use from company X or company Y, you get different results because of the epitopes that they recognize. So you cannot trust a housekeeping protein unless you validate it, because each is made to different epitopes. Most companies don't tell you what epitopes they're raised to. The modifications on these, as well as other things that are happening, and linear dynamic range. Let's take a look at some results from my lab. You can see here, this was published last year in Analytical Biochemistry. We found that it didn't matter whether you use stain-free or Ponzo S, they both were great for total protein staining. We found stain-free a little better with respect to sensitivity because of the slope of the curve. Now, this is Ponzo staining. This is also Ponzo staining. Look at how bad this linearity is now. The difference is Ponzo came from a different company. So you have problems not just with the housekeeping proteins, but even with total protein staining, depending on how you do it. So again, where you get that Ponzo is important. Some people make their own Ponzo. Some people, how many people here have used Ponzo as staining before? Great. How many people do it for 1 minute or less and then image? Right, so we have a few. How many people do it for 5 minutes and then image? Right, so see the variation right in this class. Some people do it for 1 minute, some people do it for 2 minutes, some people do it for 5 minutes, some people do it without proper shaking, some people do it with just holding it in their hand. How many people have realized that after you do Ponzo staining, if you leave it for any length of time, you lose a lot of the sensitivity? Yeah. How many people have realized if you take a Ponzo blot after you stain it and you just drop one drop of water on one part, within 1 minute, that area where the drop of water is has a different sensitivity than the rest of the blot? Yeah, those are serious problems. Now, those can all be overcome if you know those problems and you take care of them. But a lot of people don't take care of them. And I watch when my undergrads are in the lab and they do, and they all make this mistake because they rinse off most of the Ponzo and then the water, and then they leave a little bit of water because they're not that careful, and the water will be only in half the gel. And then they'll show me a picture, half the gel looks like it has twice as much protein as the other half. And they'll ask me what happened. And I said, think about it. And one or two are able to guess, but the others have no clue. But the key is water being on that is really important. So stains like Cipro and stuff are actually better, but they cost more. So that's why we actually like these stains free, because the cost was only $1 more for us per gel. So cost efficiency wise, that worked out for us. Depending on what people do, you know, you may want to make your own and put your own label in them. But everybody's different. But what was really frightening is look at the GAPDH and the actin. Now, this is GAPDH from a well-known company, antibody. Doesn't work at all in heart. There's no sensitivity from 10 to 50 microgram. If I use a different GAPDH from another company, it worked fine until 20 microgram. So again, different batches and different companies sell different quality stuff. But the moral is, no matter where I bought it from, both actin and GAPDH never went above 25 microgram for linearity. While with the total protein staining, no matter what I use, and I also use something called deep blue staining and some other ones, they all work well up to 50 microgram. So already you had twice as much dynamic range. Now, what's the average concentration you load on a blot? Is it around 25 to 30 microgram per lane? From the literature, that's what I get. And I load about 25 microgram also average. That's your average. If you were to use in heart, if you were to do that and use actin or GAPDH, no matter what antibody I use, it'll be wrong. So housekeeping proteins are excellent once you validate that we will work within the range that you're going to use them. Nothing is wrong with housekeeping proteins, except that you have to make sure that they work for your tissue and system that you're using. This is now at higher concentrations. We see that stain-free in our hands is good to about 60 microgram. Now, another thing that people don't realize is when people quote concentrations, it really depends on what method they use. If you use Bradford assay, if you use BC assay, if you use a nanodrop, they all give you different concentrations for the same sample. So you have to really be clear. So this is 60 in my scale, which is using a nanodrop, not calibrated to BSA, just calibrated to the amount of tryptophan and tyrosines. On the Bradford assay, this will be slightly higher. This would be around 80 microgram. So you have to know the scale and stuff that people are using. You can see the Ponzo is still linear there, but the slope is a lot less, so you wouldn't see differences and changes as clear. But both of them are not great even at higher concentrations. So this brings up the point. When people are going after these low target proteins, and I've seen some papers loading 150 microgram of protein, it not just scares me, but it really horrifies me, because I know clearly it's wrong. And they're quantifying and saying this is changing. There's no quantification that can be used, no method, housekeeping protein or total protein stain or any kind of stain that will allow you to quantify that accurately. Like with every system, whatever you're using, understand how to use. When we started using the stains-free, we weren't happy because we were getting images like this with a high background. It turns out you have to image it wet. So right after you transplant it, you have to image it, and then you get the high sensitivity. Right, but that wasn't in Bio-Rad catalogs, that wasn't in any of their things. So, you know, you make adaptations quickly and get it fixed. One other thing we like is we were using Cipro before, and it was taking us a long time to quantify very small amounts. We were able to find that using this stain-free, we were able to quantify very small amounts. Here, my lab focuses on proteasome, and this is proteasome purified from hearts, and it's only 200 nanogram we're loading here. And this 200 nanogram, we want to see, because we're doing competition studies, we want to see what inhibitors that we don't know bind to the active site. So we use a compound called MV151, which is a fluorescently labeled tag. That tag binds to the active site. We are now trying to compete it with unknown compounds to see if they bind the active site. And this is the control, and these are two compounds which didn't affect. And this is a positive control, which is MG132, which is a well-known inhibitor of the proteasome. And you can see it prevents the fluorescent binding there. After this, we can immediately image just with the stain-free and get our image to tell us that we loaded the correct amount, that everything looks good. So it doesn't matter here that we couldn't even use a housekeeping protein because it's a purified sample. But once you have a representative number of tryptophans in there, because the principle of stain-free is binding to tryptophan residues, you can get a good image. This is another paper from PLOS One, which I want to emphasize, because if you look, you can see beta-actin is really very variable between tissues. And this is why actin is not a good standard for heart, because it's so much there already that even when you load small amounts of it, it's already saturated. You can see very clearly here the amount of beta-actin there. While another tissue like spleen, it may be great as a standard because there's so little of it there that it gives you nice linearity. So you have to know the tissue that you're using. So for some tissues, total stains-free is great. But because I do proteomics and I'm screening antibodies, I don't want to be going through when I'm testing something for someone, say I'm doing a new tissue spleen, I don't want to have to be testing which antibody is best. I know total protein is going to work, so it saves me time and effort. Here they did a quantification, and what was interesting here is look at the linearity of beta tubulin in their sample. This is neuronal samples, 8 micrograms. Above 10 microgram, it was no longer linear. Now, who does Western blots below 10 microgram for complex samples? Anybody here? Very rarely, right? The average person is not going down to that level unless they have a high expressed protein or doing something specific. So this here is showing it a little more detail. Here now, they use an innovative method, so they're doing something similar to stains-free. So they're running two gels at the same time, and one gel, they're labeling with a fluorescent dye. And they're using that to quantify. Now, that's very powerful and very good, but I don't know, I don't like to waste a gel just to quantify. I like to do everything on the same gel because I think it's better for cost and better for efficiency. But the idea is good. So if you have your blot and you're staying with a fluorescent stain, it works great too, I've done that too. It's just it costs a little bit more. But that's great too. It works great in our hands. And you can see the linearity is great. So this is total protein stain again with fluorescent label. So it doesn't have to be ECL, it doesn't have to be Comasi. It can be any kind of total protein stain, and they all seem to work. And what's even more interesting, if we take the region just here, between like 40 and 80 kilodalton, it's still linear. So it's just a combination. Having a lot of proteins gives you a much more unbiased ratio than going after just a few. This is pretty interesting. I just want to focus on this one. So even among the same T tissue. This is mouse sciatic nerve. They found differences in expression. So if they took from here or here, they found differences in level expression of actin. And we see the same thing in heart. If you take the atria and you compare it to the ventricle, there are different levels of expression of actin. So even in the same tissue, you have to be careful using housekeeping proteins. So common controls are differentially expressed in a lot of tissues and a wide range of animals. And quantitative Western blotting of this type of spinal muscular atrophy reveals that if you were to use beta actin, you get a 20% skew just between the data because of the flaw of the actin. Now, a lot of the changes that we see in the literature are about 20%. So these controls are not restricted to just the nervous system, but they found it occurring problems in bone, fat, and internal organs. On top of that, they found that these control proteins are not consistent even between the same different regions of the same tissue. So you can see problems there. Let's turn to a different set of problems. How many people validate the antibody to make sure it's linear within what they do? Very few labs. I do every time I use a new antibody. Why? Look at this antibody, RBT4. Does not work. No linearity at all, it's saturated. While other antibodies that are good, they will work as well as your total protein staining. It'll give you the same level of sensitivity and work in the same linear dynamic range as your total protein staining. But 25% of antibodies don't do that. And you all have no clue in your lab which ones do and which ones don't. And that's a major concern, because you're quantifying with this antibody, and we load 50 micrograms for some low expressing protein, because we say, okay, total protein staining is linear, it's gonna work, and then you quantify, you get wrong results, inaccurate results. And I'm really concerned because I want quality data out there. So my interest is that we all improve as a group in Western blotting, because it's such a powerful technique and it offers so much. So a lot of people don't realize the importance of having a positive or a negative control, especially if they're doing something that's critical to the manuscript. If your manuscript is saying protein X is increasing or decreasing, and this is critical to your conclusion, you have to really validate that that is what is really changing. There are many cases now where the antibody recognizes something that's the same molecular mass as the protein that in a knockout mouse. So the protein is no longer there, verified by other methods, yet the antibody is still recognizing a protein there at the same molecular mass. So we have to be really careful. So one of the things that has really improved over the last few years is a lot of companies are selling overexpressed proteins. Some companies have already done the controls, but a lot of companies have not. How many people have bought an antibody before that had no picture, no Western done on it, because they were just desperate for any antibody that would work? Yeah, this has all happened to us. And then you were sorry you did it. Right? There's a reason why they don't have a picture most of the time. And when they do have a picture, a lot of the times those pictures are of overexpressed proteins, which is not a normal situation in the cell. So they work great with overexpressed proteins, but when you bring it down to the level of a liver or a kidney, and you see, wow, you know, and then the postdoc asks you, which protein should I pick, right? Because there's so many around the molecular weight that you expect. That's why it's important. So for anything critical in my research, I actually am a biochemist by training, so I purify. Right now you can buy any clone for any gene you want, most of them available in bacterial expression vectors for like $85. So for $200, you can express a small amount and have a recombinant, a histag protein. You can pull it down. You can have undergrads do this in about 3-4 hours, and you have a purified protein to test as your positive control. This is your best positive control you can ever have. It works great. There are cell lines overexpressing these that are available for sale by many companies too, and these are also great. What's harder to get is the negative controls. These are cell lines where it's knocked out or tissues. So what a lot of people do, and what I do sometimes, is get the peptides from the company. Companies sometimes sell peptides to make sure it's targeting a specific band over others. Secondly, you can compete with the protein that you made yourself. to make sure it's binding to and preventing binding to the specific site on the Western blot. So this is something that should open your eyes a lot. So we work on ubiquitination, ubiquitin proteasome system, isolation, and we have found that both ubiquitination and isolation, depending on the antibody you use, from what company, you can get the result you want. Case in fact here, this is looking at young and old tissue. And there's a collaboration with another lab, Subodin. And these are rat hearts, which is from young rats, which is 8 months old, and from old rats, which is 30 months old. And we all know that as you age, we're no longer to be as energetic or, you know, maintain the lifestyle that we used to have when we were 20. So a lot of things happen at the level of all your muscles, including your heart. Your heart actually changes at multiple, and the literature is confused about what happens to ISG15. And there's a reason for that, because we compared 7 different antibodies. I show 5 here. We showed 3 from Santa Cruz, 1 from Cell Signaling, 1 from eBioscience. Which 2 look alike? None. Everyone gave a different result. I put the molecular weights of the bands to show you all. No 2 gave the identical bands in combination. Some had overlap. What made it worse is if you use this antibody, it will show you that this sample is higher than this sample, while all the other experiments suggest the opposite. Here shows this is higher than this, while all the other experiments show that older is higher than lower than young, while here shows young is higher than old. So you can get different results with different antibodies. How many people are not scared? Right? But the good news is that there are standards to this, and we actually could have ruled out. And we found that one of these antibodies, meaning this one, is actually wrong. The others were all working, but to different degrees. Because we can buy isolated proteins, and we can make ourselves, and we can test the specificity. Plus, I have ISG15 in my lab, too. So what the average scientist, he will just buy this, use it, get a result, publish it. And other people can't reproduce it. So what do we do? I think it's time that we need a minimum reporting standard for all Western blots. We need to know how people actually did their Western blots so that other people can reproduce it. Right now, do you know that you cannot reproduce any Western blot in literature? Show me any paper where you can reproduce it. You can't. Because if they do include the catalog number of the antibody, the primary, they don't tell you how they actually blocked. They don't tell you the secondary antibody catalog number. And all those things matter. You cannot reproduce anything in the literature right now. It's a serious problem. You can make an excuse for why you can't get their data. And that's not good science. So I believe we need, and I'm suggesting this because I'm an academic editor of Plus One, and I'm suggesting to Plus One that in the future articles submitted there, they have to have these basic criteria. Because it's not so much the Western, but just the fact that we know. So if we think it's a bad Western, we can check what they actually did and validate with our stuff. It allows a lot better for science. Do you all agree? So how do we do that? Right now, a lot of Western blots are a major source of concern in many published papers. There are several editorials that were written on this, on Western blots and the problems, not just from people manipulating data, but problems of reproducibility. And a lot of people don't implement proper controls or replicates. And researchers need to be aware of some of the problems I just specified. So what can we do? I'm not going to read through this because I just put it there for you all to go through. But the key things is we don't just have to have the catalog number, but we need the lot number too. Batch to batch from the same company, especially anybody here use phospho antibodies? Who have had 2 batches of phospho antibodies that are identical? No one. The quality varies drastically, even from the same company. That's something that we can't avoid. That's why every time you get a batch of antibody that's different, you have to validate it yourself, make sure it's working. Don't just trust the company. Companies do a great job. Sometimes the company do a horrible job. Right? So if they have a lot of validation, that helps you move faster. but it doesn't stop you from making sure it's within the linear range. Another key feature that people don't realize is the amount of total protein. Few people actually say how much they actually load for the gel. A lot of people are using X-ray film and they don't even say it. They don't even tell you. I've heard recently that some people that were using X-ray film went back to X-ray film. And I always cringe when I hear that, because obviously they weren't taught how properly to use the digital imager. I don't care what digital imager you're using, you can't compare it with film. Technology is just so much more advanced. So this is a workflow in my lab that we have modified from the original, what Bio-Rad calls their V3. We have changed it. And this is how we typically do a Western blot when we validate the antibody already. And in our lab, it takes about 3 hours to do Western blot. We don't leave blots overnight, typically. Guess why? Anybody? We have found actually that a lot of antibodies actually behave worse overnight. Some are better overnight, but in general, in our hands, we found better results with shorter time. But the key was cutting the amount of blocking reagent with the antibody. So notice here, when we block, we are blocking, primary antibody, right, only in TTBS, or sometimes in 1% TTBS if it's a bad antibody. We found the signal rises so much and the background rises so small relative that the difference gives us such a good discrimination that we don't have a problem. We have found that that 5% milk actually inhibits a lot of things. When we went from 5% to 3% milk for blocking, we got much better background staining, believe it or not. Or BSA. For some antibodies, BSA work better. A lot of people don't realize the solution that they make things in is critical too. How many people realize that for 20% of antibodies, PBS works better than TBS? Some labs never touch PBS. So there's a big difference. If you go to PS website, there's some pictures of differences between a few of the antibodies with PBS and TBS, and there's one that they recommend PBS for. And in TBS, you basically get no reaction. It's that strong a difference. So understanding these key differences, when you're trying, we typically go with TTBS because that's the one that works with 80%. And if it doesn't work well, we go with PBS. And in some cases, we see the PBS works. So these little tricks help along the way. But another key is the blocking with 3% BSA, try it, or with 3% milk, works better than 5%. Secondly, if you overblock, blocking overnight is the quickest way to kill your blot. Overblocking is a big problem. And this is what happens when you have the primary antibody in the 5% milk. You can do primary antibody overnight in 1% milk and it will work a lot better. So try that. You will see better image and sharper images. So another thing is when you're washing, a lot of people wash in the same container. Try changing containers after your second wash. You'll see a drastic improvement in background. So instead of just one container, throwing out, new buffer. After you do that, transfer the gel to a new container, totally new, with washing buffer. You'll see a drastic improvement in your background. Yes, it's more effort and it's more things to clean, but you know, it's worth it in the end because time matters and quality matters. So the washing steps, you have seen we have changed it. We only do 1 minute, 1 minute, 2 minute, 4 minute. And that works as well as 3 5-minute steps. But the key is at this point, it goes into a new container. Because a lot of containers, the plastic keeps antibodies in the corners that release slowly, and you can't get rid of them. A new container now, hopefully you washed it properly, takes care of that problem. The image, again, a digital imager has so much improved our technology that I rely on it totally. I use automated imaging. So it allows me to see, it goes and find the maximum where it's saturated, and then it gives me the best image below that. And then I take a picture over that, and I take a picture below that. So I always take a minimum of 3 pictures of a gel. I always take one that's saturated too. So that allows me to then do a lot of different things after and to compare. And the software is another major factor that people have problems with. So recently, I'm very glad to see a lot of changes in the area with better software coming out. There's at least three or four different softwares out there now that all work great. And why they work great? Because they employ something called the rolling disk. How many people know about the rolling disk background? So great, we have about five or six people, but most of them probably from companies. So a big problem with quantification, if I take three blots and I give three undergrads to analyze them, and I tell them watch the online tutorials, and I give them software from different companies, they all come back with incorrect results because they use an inefficient system to quantify. The rolling disk is the most accurate method because it's subtracting the background below the band, not above the band or below the band, which is a flawed technique in the long run. Because how many people have seen that their blots have a different intensity on one side than the other? That's not uncommon. And that affects. So the rolling disk allows you now to take care of the background below. And many software have it now. Bio-Rad software has it. Lycor software, which is free online, has it. And some other companies have it. And people are not making use of it. And that amazes me. Because you do it in your own lab. Do the comparison of the old school. You copy an area, you paste. What I used to do when I was a graduate student, because I didn't know better. Right? And you'll see a big difference. So quantification is a big problem, but it's way beyond the scope of this. That's a whole lecture by itself, because there's so many ways that you can do quantification wrong, and a lot of people do, unfortunately. And with total protein staining, you cannot quantify the empty lane, because I see people using the lane on top, turning the band sideways, all kind of, they don't work properly. You have to use rolling background, rolling disk background. So the conclusions are, we need to validate our antibodies if we're going to use housekeeping proteins. But if we're using total protein, we still need to validate that it's within the dynamic range of the amount you use. So it doesn't matter what you use, you have to validate. Just in our hands, we found total protein to be easier because we don't have to spend money on stripping a blot, reprobing, or for the price of the antibody. So we found it a little bit easier and more sensitive. On top of that, you want to make sure that when you choose a total protein stain, it's convenient for you. Everybody will have their choices. It doesn't matter what you use, just make sure it's valid for what you're doing. Quantification using this rolling disk method is recommended because it will give you improvements in your quality of your data. Differences that you might not have seen before, you will see. And I always tell people, trust your eye. If you're seeing a difference with your eye, your results should show that. If you're not getting that, something is wrong with what you're doing. I've seen papers published where one band is like three times the size of the other band and they get no difference. And they're like, and the error is small, impossible. So there's clear problems there. Validate the antibodies to your protein of interest. And if you can, find a lab that have a digital imager and stop using that film. Because film is great, but you have to validate it. And validation is not easy for film because the saturation is so quick. You have to really know what you're doing. So when I was a graduate student, I made this website, and it was visited by 10,000 people in the first 2 years. I've never updated it, but it's quite useful still. These were the problems that I ran into when I was a graduate student, and I ran into many problems because no one there knew what they were doing, including myself. So we learned on the job, and I poured many gels that never worked, and I learned a lot about that. But this I did more recently in 2009, and Vanderbilt is now hosting it. But a new one is going to be coming out. I did one now that's three times the size, but I'm not finished. So it's about 40 pages of problems with Western blotting and how you can solve them. Yep, there's that many. And this is, there are many sites, but I like the Western Blotting Doctor for people who are now starting because they have pictures. And we are visual, most of us are scientists, so it's good to see. So you can go and take your blot. Oh, yeah. These are the likely causes. And these are some papers on stains-free that have come out recently, including one from my lab. In fact, two from my lab. We had another paper here that you use that. And these are other normalizations. So it doesn't matter what you use. Once you use it correctly, I'm a firm proponent for that. These are using comparing total protein versus housekeeping proteins. And you can see just from the title, right, that it shows that there are problems with some of the others. And this is my lab and people who do the work. And we have some gifted undergrads who help with this. And because they do this all the time, they get really good at it. So with that, the important part of the talk, which is the discussion section, I would like to start now. Thank you.